afternoon and welcome. Today we gather to remember, honor, and celebrate the life of Kate Millen. Whether you are Kate's family, friends, or just an admirer, thank you for being here. I'm the Reverend Skylar Vogel, the senior minister here at Fourth Universalist Society, and it's a great privilege to be with you on this special day. Today we mark the passing of someone who was deeply loved, not only for her accomplishments, which were many, but also for the person she was.
Kate helped lay the foundation for a new kind of feminism, and yet she was also kind, unassuming, and a loyal friend. She was a fierce advocate for the marginalized and the underdog, a lover of the arts, and possessed an open mind, brilliant, that led her to identify structures of inequality in truly revolutionary kinds of ways. We here at Fourth Universalist are especially touched to host Kate's service. It's a reunion of sorts. 52 years ago, Kate was married right here. But even beyond that, our congregation, our values, Unitarian Universalism, our faith tradition, we hope represents the kind of community that Kate would believe in. Our tradition was the first to ordain women into the clergy, all the way back in 1863, and has counted among its members feminists like Elizabeth Cady Stanton and Susan B. Anthony. It is in this radical and remarkable spirit that we honor Kate's life today. And while we mourn for Kate, let us celebrate the person she was and affirm the life she lived. Let us remember that so long as we embody the spirit of her life, she is never truly gone and lives within us. In this sacred and special time today, we can find comfort in these words by the Unitarian Universalist minister, Kenneth Collier. I do not know where we go when we die. I do not know what the soul is, or what death is, or when, or why. What I know is that the song once sung cannot be unsung, and the life once lived cannot be unlived, and the love once loved cannot be unloved. May our time together today pay tribute to Kate's memory for the love and light and song she brought into this world and to all of us. Thank you again for being here and welcome. Our service today begins with a song.
Thank you. Wouldn't Kate just love this? Welcome, everyone, and thank you all for coming out today in memory of Kate Millett. We are profoundly grateful to the church elders and staff who have helped us tremendously, providing us with this beautiful space and showing us so much warmth, hospitality, and generosity. We thank the Veteran Feminists of America, which has organized and is hosting this memorial together with Sophie Keir, Kate's remarkable partner and spouse. VFA is an organization Kate loved and supported from the day it was founded, and she was, in fact, one of its founders. We share great sadness with Kate's family, who have come out in force from out of town. Kate's niece, Lisa Millett Rao, representing the family, will talk more about them in a few minutes. And we thank our great lineup of speakers and performers who will honor and mourn Kate this afternoon through the joy and magic of special music and language. Finally, we extend condolences to Sophie Keir, who prolonged Kate's life and gave her quality of life, who provided love, stability, safe harbor, and companionship. Sophie was Kate's home and her heart. If there is any comfort to be found in the awful fact of Kate Millett's death, it is this. The last thing Sophie heard from Kate was her laughter. The last thing Kate heard was Sophie's laughter. Thank you, Sophie, for keeping Kate alive, well, and happy, despite so many challenges, and for 39 years together carrying the torch of her work forward. We remember and pay tribute today to a feminist who was a trailblazer and a rebel, a troublemaker, an anarchist, and a gangster. Kate Millett was many other things too, as we all know, and those are well documented in the history books. But she grooved on the idea of herself as a gangster, and she savored the image of being tough. She wasn't that at all. Kate was sensitive and shy, without normative layers of protection from outside hurts and assaults. It seemed as if she wore her skin from the inside out. This exquisite sensibility served her well as an artist and writer, but her personal vulnerability was often an open wound. This is a hard loss, putting an end to an almost 60-year relationship. I know, people say that Kate will live on forever, but it doesn't help. I miss her. As I have said and written many times, she was my intellectual sparring partner and my very beloved friend, interwoven within the spine of my own life and personal history. In our early years, we ran around Greenwich Village together, both of us so young and full of promise. Well, to be frank, I wasn't quite sure how much promise Kate had. She lived on the Bowery and had very little money. More worrisome than that, she embraced downward mobility. Had a mindset, it seemed to me, of reverse elitism. It actually thrilled her to live as and where she did. What an odd duck, I thought. I didn't understand, couldn't understand, born and raised as I was in the slums of Brooklyn, an ambitious kid just out of college, dreaming of success. The common goal of everyone in my neighborhood was a driving desire to get out of the slums, not aspire to living in one. What was wrong with her? Well, I knew immediately what was right with her. She was undeniably a genius, with an elegant mind and a steel trap memory. Everyone in our circle was smart, but Kate was in another league. She did not just read books, she ingested them, swallowed them whole like a literary glutton whose appetite is never satisfied. Who was she then, this alien expat from St. Paul, this scholar and artist who lived in her head and seemed to inhabit a universe of her own, one that was not always intelligible to me, quirky, disquieting, interesting, provocative, amusing, intense, and very, very naughty. And original for sure. Kate was definitely not your everything in moderation, nothing in excess kind of gal, as Socrates counseled. Whatever she did was extreme. She lived without safety net or security, no apparent means or obvious future. A very young woman alone, living a marginal existence, dangerously on the edge. But she was game, looking forward to the next party or the next book to be read, her life an unfolding adventure, or as she said later, introducing me to an entirely new vocabulary, a happening. Kate Millett, to her core, was a downtown artist. She was terribly shaken when, in her later years, the city evicted and relocated her, and screaming, heartsick and furious about losing her home. She was probably the only person in the world who believed that being evicted from the Bowery was a step down. Kate was very pale in those early days, and I often feared she was ill, worrying about her as I always did and would for almost six decades. Her pallor so alarmed me that I mistook it for sickliness, not the love sickness it probably was. She fell in love easily and often, and she suffered intensely from this malady. But when Kate discovered feminism, her passion for this new cause burned bright, different from the flameouts of her personal relationships that so often brought her grief and brought her down. For her, romantic love was a bad drug, an opportunistic infection that took hold of her soul. She just wasn't good at it. But she was good at feminism. Psychically, she suddenly seemed turbocharged, and just as suddenly, she became famous. One minute, she was slaving away at her doctoral dissertation, just like the rest of us, and the next minute, she was the Mao Zedong of women's liberation, the principal theoretician of the women's movement, one of the 20 most important persons of the 20th century, according to the New York Times, and her likeness graced the cover of Time magazine. What? Who? Our Katie? No way. Well, yes way, actually. What changed everything was the book, that miraculous life-altering tome, which had been her PhD dissertation, but later would be described as the Bible of the women's movement, Sexual Politics, or Sexpol, as Kate called it, transformative, brilliant, groundbreaking. 10 more books would eventually follow, and as always, a ton of art. Andrea Dworkin said, "I cannot think of anyone who accomplished what Kate Millett did with this one book. It remains the alpha and omega of the women's movement. Anything that feminists have done is foreshadowed, predicted, or encouraged by Sexual Politics." Kate held the pub party for Sexpol at a dive in the Bowery, CBGB's, right down the street from her apartment, of course. It was the most way out book launching I ever attended, but that's another story. Some years ago, Kate sent me a letter. "I never have said thank you enough. Surely have not been sentimental. Have held on to our old tough girl stance from when we were New York kids just out of college. So here's a thank you note. Already I feel myself clamming up." This was quintessential Kate in her middle years, looking at herself over her own left shoulder with that fierce intelligence, observing her faults with an unsparing eye, trying to be more explicitly human, but always in a struggle against herself, wryly confessional. And then, at the very moment of reaching out, she shuts down, retreats, and runs away. So here's a thank you note, already I feel myself clamming up. Years later, when we were morphing into our new identities as movement elders and foremothers, whatever that is, things changed. Kate now began each letter and each conversation with a simple declaration: "I love you very much." Her handwriting wavered, no longer the bold, black, recognizable lines of her idiosyncratic artistry, but scraggly, wandering across and down the page at a diffident pace. Her speech was halting with many silences. She had fewer words, but said so much more meaningful to me than when the sentences gushed from her pen to stun a nation. Her old struggle against self-incriminating sentimentality was gone. Now, Kate herself is gone, and that is unimaginable. So I'll say it back, sweet Kate, our very own Catherine the Great. I say it unlike you for too many years, without angst or struggle or self-consciousness. I love you very much, too. Well done, Katie, your life, so very well done. Goodbye, old friend.
Sorry, if I stand up, then my mind is not going to be too clear. This way, I can talk what I want to talk. Kate, I loved you. I love you even, well, of course, now. All of us love you forever because you were such an incredible, unique person. I met her when I went back to Japan, for some reason, I don't know. And there was a crowd of guys, and I don't know what they were doing. But then I realized that in the center of that, Kate was there. And Kate was not doing anything to influence them to work like the usual guys. Kate was just telling them how she felt about the life, how she felt about the world. And all these guys, they were artists, and they just couldn't stop listening to her. And it was really amazing. So I wanted to get near to her, but it was very difficult. So I gave up and just waited for her to finish it. And then we said hi. That's how we said hi together. That's the first time. And each time I meet Kate, Kate would... Well, I was a little bit introspective and shy, but she was like this. Hi, Yoko. So I said, oh, okay. And I remember her so well. Her smile is not the kind of smile that you see in anybody else. It was just part of her body. And it just came out. It was beautiful. And then after Japan, I went immediately to her loft, which was, I forgot where it was, but in a kind of place that the loft is, you know. And she was living with this Japanese guy. And the Japanese guy was an artist too. But there was such a difference between her art and his art. I thought, well, you know, he's good for an assistant. And I think he knew about that, and I think he didn't mind it. He was a very, very nice guy. And Kate was, as usual, talking. My history of being a feminist, I don't want to go into that. It's not that interesting. But my husband, he was always complaining. He said, you know, I want people to know that there are men who are feminists. But, you know, I like to create a kind of a part where we can, all the men can discuss about being a feminist. But there's nobody around. I said, well, you know, why don't you try? But I don't think he tried. Before he tried, he went far away from us. And then the next was my son, Sean, who's a very good musician and very opinionated, just like us, you know, of course. But he's now complaining that feminists are very hard on male feminists. So I said, look, you have to do something about it. You can, well, he said, well, mommy, you were a feminist for a long time, so maybe you can talk to him, talk to them. I said, no, I'm not gonna talk to them. You have to find a way to get there. And so, you know, but he is a feminist too. And I know many, many, many. Well, I wouldn't say many, but I know many strongly feminist women and men. And that's how it is now. It's very good. We are all feminists, men and women. And we can create a very strong world together with a little help from women. My husband said something about it, you know, that I forgot how she said it, but and the fact that we have the women to teach us, kind of thing, you know, and so we can get there. And it was really amazingly, incredibly stupid that the whole world was just thinking of women as their slaves, convenient slaves. And we were so scared and so hurt. I have to tell you about this short story, very short. I found this woman who was looking very ugly. The reason she was looking ugly was her expression, you know, like this. And I said, she was working for us. So I said, are you happy? She said, no. Well, what makes you not happy? Well, life. But then she started to tell me that this was in England, and all English men, meaning working class men, keep their wives pregnant every year, so they won't run away. What an incredible idea. But and so I was really touched by that. There are many women who's still suffering and can't say anything about it, because it's just a scary world. Scary world where if they stood up and said something, they might be killed. So you should know that. Most of you are probably middle class or upper class or something. But there are many, many women who are suffering, and but it's not true to say they're all working class, because I know some women in upper class just disappeared for no reason. So we have to create a world that we can all do things together and with a big smile. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Yoko. Kate loved boots. If you had boots, you could do anything. I needed some boot power today, so I brought them, and I'm just going to tuck them under here. My name is Lisa Millett Rao, and Kate was my aunt. First, I want to start out by thanking the Veteran Feminists of America for putting this on. It seems like it was just yesterday, but it was really 2 decades ago in 1998 when they honored Kate, and I brought all my college roommates and the room was filled. But Kate's missing today. Yoko mentioned, I think we've got a budding theme here, and it's Kate's smile. The program is exquisite. You know, Kate not only had an exquisite smile, it was unconventional, like Kate. It kind of leaned left. And most of the people in this room who know Kate know that when she would look at you with that twinkle in her eye and the left-leaning smile, you were about to go on an adventure. Or she knew that you knew that what somebody was saying wasn't right, but she communicated volumes with that smile. I want to introduce the family that came here on behalf of Kate today. Her older sister, Sally Millett, who's the one person in this room that's known her forever. Sophie Keir, who was introduced earlier. Peggy Millett, who was the half-sister Kate met later in life. Her niece, Victoria Rao. Two nephews, Caleb Rao and Nathan Krasner. Her nephew-in-law, as she called him, Larry Krasner, who just finished a race for District Attorney of Philadelphia. And then there were a number of people who wanted to be here today. Stephen Rao and Christine Muirs had tickets here and health kept them away, but I hear they're watching online. Kate Rao also bought her ticket, Kate's namesake, and is watching online as well. David Rao and Kristen Weigard, and then a ream of grand nieces and nephews. Our Aunt Kate, she insisted it was aunt, not a little bug aunt. I want to tell you what, from the family's perspective, about Aunt Kate. We knew her as an artist first. She would come for visits, and she would open her suitcase and pull out her art supplies and get down on the floor cross-legged with us, equal, because we were equal. And then we did art together. And even her art was unconventional. She didn't do pumpkins by carving and gashing them. It was much more pacifistic and nonviolent to paint them. And many people who have been to the farm have seen her pumpkins that were just exquisite. She also talked to us like we were adults. You know, in the 50s and 60s, adults didn't get cross-legged on the floor and talk to you like that. So even in terms of child psychology, she was ahead of her time. And her sculptures. As little kids, we were in love with her sculptures. Kate would take tables, and she'd add arms to them. She would take stools and add feet to them. She brought them alive. They should have freedom too. They should be able to move too. Freedom, liberation. Even if you were an object, you could move if you want. My very favorite sculpture of Kate's was this piano stool. She put two legs on it and a good pair of sturdy boots. It was almost as if she was saying, you know, if you ever get sick of people sitting on you, you can run away. You can hide. You've got freedom, liberation. If you were a thing or a person, liberation and freedom is what Kate believed in. We later learned that Kate was an artist of words, too. And for all of the people in this room, I'm sure everybody here has read her work. It was almost as if she thought the words were her friends, and she sat down on the floor cross-legged and played with them. She was unconventional in how she wrote as well, big surprise. She challenged notions of grammar. Sometimes you needed a run-on sentence to express something. Sometimes a sentence should be just one word. And she was also non-hierarchical in how she saw words. There was no hierarchy. You could take a big, complex word, and it was really beautiful if you mixed it with a pithy, short one. They should all get along, be integrated. Gave you better meaning, and things were more beautiful that way, at least from Kate's perspective. She wasn't just an artist of words, though. Kate was a true scholar of words. She went to the University of Minnesota and graduated magna cum laude. And, you know, her junior and senior year, my mother, Sally, told me that she couldn't afford her dues. She wasn't so great with budget, as Yoko mentioned, and didn't have the money to pay the dues. Well, her cum was so high, they said, it doesn't matter. You don't need to pay the dues. You can bring up the collective cum of the sorority. And so that was cool. She was studying words at University of Minnesota and then went on to Oxford and became the first American woman to graduate with honors from St. Hilda's College, studying words again. Then she came back to Columbia, again, to study words and literature, comparative literature, and again, graduated with distinction. Now, it was at Columbia, you know, when you get to the point where you have to write your dissertation, they drill it into your head. It's got to be something someone has never said before. It's got to be unique. It's got to contribute to the world in a way that's useful. Well, we already know all of these schools thought she was a brilliant student. So she sat down to do her homework, and Sexual Politics was born. Kate Millett looked at words. She knew how powerful they were. She understood that with words, you could oppress. You could take beautiful language and convince women that what was supposed to be written as romance was really oppression. But if you read the words, they look beautiful. So if we are in love, shouldn't we be objects? Shouldn't we go along? And Kate, like the beautiful artist she is, revealed the invisible ink below. And it was, she used her power with words, just like she added freedom to her sculptures with arms and legs. She took words and freed women in writing Sexual Politics. It's interesting that the same year that Kate finished Sexual Politics, her sister Sally decided, you know what? I may be in my 40s, but I'm going to law school. And as Sexual Politics came out, Kate was in demand to speak all the time, and so she was always busy, and so sometimes in Nebraska they'd say, Sally Millett, you come out and speak as well. So the two sisters, the two Millett sisters, were kind of running around trying to change the world and bring women's rights all around. In 1970, all the nieces and nephews were between the ages of 6 and 13. In August of 1970, Kate Millett was on the cover of Time magazine. We thought that was so cool. I mean, she was just doing her homework, and she got on the cover of Time magazine. She wasn't trying to start a revolution. She was doing her homework. We thought that was very cool, but our mother told us that Kate was upset. She didn't want to be on the cover of Time magazine. It was a movement. It wasn't about Kate Millett. She kept saying over and over again, it's thousands of women. It's human rights. It's women's rights. It's not Kate Millett. But they didn't listen. She didn't pose for that picture on the cover. Because if she had posed, she would have that beautiful, exquisite smile. She wouldn't look so stern and angry. They put her on the cover of Time, and we thought it was great. We were so proud of her. Even if she didn't think she should be there, we still thought she was cool. And 4 short months later, we realized the wisdom of what Kate was saying. Time magazine wrote another article. This time, it was Women's Lib, a second look. You could tell by the title that something was going to be not so good about it. Friends started to whisper. Teachers started to whisper. What's bisexual? We asked our mother. She said it's when you might fall in love with a man or you might fall in love with a woman. What does that have to do with her cool book? I mean, we're not supposed to be in the room when people are doing that thing that we still weren't so clear about anyway. It's none of our business who somebody's sleeping with. And we knew our Aunt Kate. She was cool. She was fun. And they shouldn't pick on her. And people from all different angles started challenging her. Some people told her, pretend you're not bisexual. Keep it quiet. You're going to ruin the movement. Outside the movement, they attacked her. She must hate men. And they tried to undermine the movement by attacking Kate, which was precisely her point from the beginning. They were mean. They were really mean. But Kate knew that when it involves human rights, you just stand up and you have courage. She was so brave. But it was then that she learned that all mail was not necessarily a birthday card with money in it. So many of us know that that's when she stopped reading her mail. If you wanted to talk to Kate or tell her something, you had to call her. You didn't want to write her. But she did something so wonderful with the money that she got from sexual politics, she thought she was rich. So she went out and bought a farm, the farm. It was her sanctuary. It was where she would invite everyone who she loved to come whenever they wanted. They didn't even have to call in advance. Just show up. I'll always be here. You knew certain months Kate was going to be at the farm and you could go there. And the place was magical. I went to school out east, so I was often there because I didn't have the money to go home. And there began my visits to the farm for the last 4 decades. But this is what Kate did at the farm. This shows how much fun she is. She named everything on the farm. Everything had a name. There was the lavender barn. There was Sophie's chicken coop. There was the Simone de Beauvoir room. There was the Marilyn Monroe room. Even closets had names. The Fibber McGee closet, she would get that twinkle in her eye. And every room was decked out with art and oriental carpets that she had found at some estate sale or another. One visit we were up there, and Kate said, "I was thinking of starting an art colony. I've been doing some studying, and if you grow Christmas trees, it takes half as much time. I mean, you can do it as a part-time job. So we could have women come and work half the day, do their art the other half of the day, and the third half of the day, you would have dinner." And dinner was butter, lettuce, candles, food, Cote de Rhone, and long, long conversations. How many people in this room have been to one of Kate's farm meals? Fabulous journeys. Her farm family is here en masse. She would be so happy. But just because Kate found a refuge at the farm doesn't mean that she withdrew from the world. Sally, her sister, tells this story of Kate during World War II, when she was 10 years old, would cry and cry and cry about all the people who were killed from the bombings. And Kate lived her life that way. If there was a bully, Kate would go after the bully. She was never afraid of bullies. The bully might be government misusing its power. It might be somebody torturing a woman in a basement. It might be somebody making fun of somebody for who they loved. But Kate went after bullies, and she showed us all how to do it. I remember in 1979, Iran, there had been a revolution, and the Ayatollah Khomeini took over, and within just so fast, he stripped away the rights that women had been gaining over the last several decades. And feminists from all around the world said, "We're gonna go to Iran and stand by our sisters." But then the government, many people from the government called and said, "We can't assure your safety. If you go to Iran, it's on you. We can't protect you." Kate was undaunted. She and Sophie went off to Iran. My mother was worried sick. She called me one night. I was in Philadelphia. It was the opening night of her niece, Kristen Weygaard's show. And my mother called and said, "I've heard Kate has been arrested in Iran, so watch the news and see if you can see something." So we turned on the TV, and there was Kate being hauled off by police. And I couldn't see Sophie, and I didn't know if she was there. And this was pre-internet, pre-cell phone, so you couldn't Google it. You couldn't see. We had lived in Afghanistan a decade earlier. And in Afghanistan, if you didn't have family to feed you when you were in prison, then you might starve. So should one of us go over there? How would Kate eat? Was Sophie free and not Kate? We didn't know. And finally, we were so elated when our mother called and said that she landed safely in Paris, her favorite city. There were so many adventures, but I want to leave room for the others who have adventures to tell. But one thing that is so exciting is that at least during Kate's lifetime, she got to see the world change in large part because of the movement, because of the second wave movement, many of the people in this room who were fundamental parts of it. I remember how proud she was when the UN adopted the Convention on the Rights of People with Disabilities. It was the first human rights treaty of the 21st century. She was so proud of it. She was so proud of the Yoko Ono Award for Courage in the Arts. And then in 2013, her nieces and nephews and Sally and Sophie and I went up to Seneca Falls when she was inducted into the National Women's Hall of Fame. It was during the famous government shutdown, and Nancy Pelosi was up there as well, and we couldn't do it in a government building, so they shoved us all in a hotel. And for Kate, that was better because it was more of a party. In 2014, I sent Kate an email because in Pennsylvania, same-gender marriages were finally legal, and I was going to have the opportunity as a judge to officiate one of the first ones, so I was so excited and sent Kate an email, and she responded in like 5 minutes and said, "You must send pictures." Can you imagine? She got to see that after being bullied just because she loved women, and she got to see that the government finally came around. I'm so happy she did. You know, Gloria Steinem, our next speaker, had said at one point, the world was asleep, and Kate woke them up. But she didn't wake them up to start a fight or start a revolution. She was just trying to speak the truth and fight big bullies. So anyway, if we want to honor Kate, and I think everyone here is to honor Kate, what we should do is grab a pair of boots, put them on, pick an injustice, any injustice. She didn't pick favorites just because they affected her lives. Any human right was something you fought for. And then imagine that gorgeous, exquisite smile of hers and the twinkle she would have had in her eyes, and go out there and fight with courage. But you know, not just courage, make sure it's an adventure. On behalf of Kate's family, you're all her family, I want to thank you for being here today.
We're reaching in, We feed each other with truth and touching. This dream is true. We're coming through. This dream is true. Coming through you. This dream is true. We're coming through. This dream is true.
There's a wonderful addition to the program, Katie Saffron.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
you hear at night. It's not someone who's seen the light. It's a cold and it's a broken hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah.
Dear friends, family born, family chosen, all of us who are here to make sure that dearest Kate, giant Kate, is never, never, never forgotten, is always part of our lives. I promised to share my time with someone who those of us of an age think of as Kitty McKinnon and whose students think of as Catherine McKinnon, who Kate asked to write the introduction to the new edition of Sexual Politics and whose introduction she loved. This is Kitty. Kate was the original genius of the most important ideas that animate the women's movement, hence politics, to this day. She saw relations between the sexes as political, meaning structured by power. She pioneered literary criticism as reality criticism, as a way to get at the world when men can write it however they want, given that they can make it be however they want. Crucially, she conceived the critique of sexuality as male-dominated from the bedroom to the boardroom, and she put in parentheses, to the potted plant. Don't you kind of wish we could read Kate on Harvey Weinstein? Also to the State House and beyond, fingering male-dominated sexuality as the basis of women's lack of freedom and our inequality. All our work against rape, sexual harassment, prostitution, pornography, and sex trafficking builds on her shatteringly brilliant insights in her 1970 book, Sexual Politics. As just one example, speaking of Janae, who treats gay as well as straight sexual relations, her reading of his play, The Balcony, finds him exposing, quote, the fundamental human connection, that of sexuality, to be the nuclear model of all the more elaborate social constructs growing out of it. In itself, not only hopelessly tainted, but the very prototype of institutionalized inequality, unquote. Janae's play, set in a brothel, inequality, institutionalized, is what its relations exhibit, quote, unless clinging to male supremacy as a birthright is finally foregone, Kate argues in that context, quote, all systems of oppression will continue to function. Because of their connection to sexuality. Her prostitution papers presented women's voices speaking of their own experiences of prostitution, breaking the waves for writings and organizations of survivors of prostitution that define and drive the worldwide movement for its abolition. Kate was trenchant and funny, serious and zany, creative and steadfast. As a friend, she was generous, loyal, receptive, and passionate. Her art hangs on my walls, her words underlie my work, her support comforts my back, her voice and her smile warm my heart, her love holds my hand, she will never, never leave our side. Thank you, Kitty. And for myself, since I am lucky to share Kate's birth year, I am lucky to have known her for a seriously long time. I first was introduced to her words when our mutual friend, Sheila Tobias at Cornell, sent me pages from a friend's PhD thesis. And the three of us launched into an endeavor, as I remember, in trying to get Marx's wife's love letters into the Ladies' Home Journal. What can I tell you? It didn't happen. Subversive, but it didn't happen. And as I read them, I thought, is it possible that a female American human being could be a great global intellectual? It had never, ever entered my mind before that this was even a possibility. Then we began to hang out, and I began to hang her art on my walls where it remains. Breast art, cunt art. And she forgave me so much. She forgave me that pot made me paranoid and I wasn't that interested in smoking pot. She forgave me that I didn't know anything about wine and secretly preferred Werner's Golden Ginger Ale that I had had in Toledo. Right? She laughed at my jokes, which was a serious concession on her part, and all of my puns. She let me hold her hand at that press conference after the Time magazine cover, when we all gathered to defend her after that ridiculous, stupid attack. And so we got to be an item for like 2 weeks, I think. She continued to be my instructor in gracious living, in elegance, in seriousness. She tried to teach me how to fertilize Christmas trees on her farm. She taught me again the magic of a dinner table at that farm, where women from so many different places and spaces and ages gathered together magically at what she understood must be a third of the work of the farm. Like everybody, I think, who changes our lives seriously, deeply, I remember when she entered it. I remember every single minute that she was part of it. And I pledged myself to make sure, and I'll need help with this given the age question, right? Okay. but I pledge myself to make sure that her words are always, always out there and with us, and her spirit and her humor and her understanding and her global gift for changing our consciousness and thus changing our reality will never, never, never leave this earth. Thank you.
Our family. I think you would like us to be bare-breasted by the pond, drinking a wee bit and sharing our memories, and maybe that is yet to happen if Sophie invites us. Kate, you took your last breath on Earth in the city you loved most, Paris, the city which once welcomed expatriates Gertrude, Alice, Pablo, Ernest, and Sir James of Dublin, and where the early morning aroma of fresh bread was reason enough for you to rise too, early. I finally understood you in historical context, but only when I read Andrea Weiss's Paris Was a Woman, Portraits from the Left Bank. Then I recognized your culture, one in which sophisticated and talented lesbians took many lovers, I called them sluts, competed against each other for sexual favors, slept with their lovers' lovers, and everyone became lifelong friends and or sometimes abandoned the group entirely. Just as you belong to so many cities, just so you had so many different selves. You were many different Kates. You were Kate, the highly ceremonial hostess, offering your guests wine as if it were a libation to the gods, floating little candlelit paper boats out on the lake at the farm for the Japanese holiday of Obon. And you were also Kate, the raging mad queen, Kate, the unbearably humble, Kate, the increasingly all too silent. I miss you, Kate. Talky, Kate. You were the most cosmopolitan, the most European identified of our feminist intellectuals. Well, Andrea Dworkin was too. You believed that ideas really mattered and that intellectuals must lay their bodies down for the sake of revolution. True. You were also the Kate who could easily pass for a homeless person out on the Bowery in blustery winter weather, trying to sell your farm-grown Christmas trees. Oh, how chapped your hands were. How red were your cheeks. I would go and try to give her coffee, or talk the talk. You were Kate, the sharecropper farmer, who, like Gerald and Scarlett O'Hara in Gone with the Wind, were adamant that owning land is everything, and that land must be kept at all costs. You drove a tractor, cut wood, stood on dangerously high ladders to get at a falling roof. My son Ariel is here. She tried to teach him how to chop wood when he was five or four, and she talked to him as if he was a grown-up, which I found very strange and endearing. Do you remember the time I visited one weekend when I was on a hard and fast deadline, and you demanded that I put my shoulder to the wheel, climb up to some unbearable height, you know, to fix a roof? Come on, Chesla, she growled, you growled. Just get on the goddamn ladder and help me do this. I was horrified, terrified, flabbergasted. but you would not let go of me until I at least planted a victory garden of flowers by your side, something I'd never done before or since. But even as Kate the farmer, you still sometimes drank your morning coffee in a French ceramic bowl. I thought that was very elegant. And always made little toasts at dinner, and were at all times surrounded by books and by bookshelves, white bookshelves. Your sexual politics was perhaps the most influential, certainly the most famous, of the second wave feminist books, although we all stood on the shoulders of the brilliant articles and demonstrations that preceded us from 1966 and a half on. Extraordinary pamphlets. I read them, I ate them like candy. That same year, Shuley Firestone published her equally amazing The Dialectic of Sex. In Flying, I loved that book. You captured the energy of the early days of breakneck feminism, activism, as well as the unexpected cruelty among feminists. And you also described what it was like to experience fame as something of a human sacrifice. I went to Kate's editor at Doubleday for Women in Madness, and Betty took me into the bathroom once and said, I need you to do something. What might that be? Can you please tell Kate to take out the lesbian parts from Flying? So I laughed. I said, no, I wasn't going to do that. And they canceled the contract. You were prescient about the ways in which some of the same women who were inspired by your work would turn on you because you were famous and something of a genius, and they were not. She wrote about that. I saw it all, I missed nothing. But I also saw how you, in your own way, exacted your due in this particular devil's bargain. Katie, you were tireless, relentless in trolling the dark side on behalf of women's freedom, and you did so doggedly, even during the dark days, the dog days, the days of despair. In the basement, Meditations on a Human Sacrifice, you more than equaled Truman Capote and Norman Mailer. In your nonfiction novel about the physical and sexual torture murder of a 16-year-old girl, Sylvia Likens, in Indianapolis, at the hands of the ringleader, a middle-aged woman named Gertrude Banaszewski, her teenage son and daughter, and some neighborhood children. They tortured Sylvia most horribly for weeks and then carved, I'm a prostitute and proud of it, into Sylvia's skin. The details are unbearable. How did you bear it? Did you? She did an art exhibit, and there was Sylvia, dressed in Kate's clothing with a wig that was like Kate's hair. And I did a real double and triple take. I was taken quite aback. In going to Iran, oh, we wondered, how are we going to get Kate out? How are we going to get Sophie out? We don't have feminist Air Force One. We have no ground troops. Even Khomeini let her go. I was so relieved. And the very next year, they asked me, the same fellow, Reza Barahini, invited me to come on International Women's Day. You understand the Muslim soul. You've been with us. Come. I said, I wouldn't even come with platoons of Marines. No, no. But there in that book, she truly grasped the misogynist nature of an Islamic theocratic regime that would go on to murder its best and its brightest. In the Loony Bin Trip, you describe being locked up for mental illness, or as you would have it, for your political beliefs. And the terrible toll such imprisonment took upon you, how offended your dignity was, and about the bouts of solitary confinement in the bin were for you literally torture, given that you were claustrophobic. Gloria and I worked on getting you out of the second loony bin in Minnesota. That's another story. Even I had a hard time with the politics of cruelty. But I soldiered on, it's about political torture. But I soldiered on fearing that your graphic depiction of state-administered torture had either become a dangerous obsession or was your way of controlling your terror about it. Katie, I want to thank you for your generosity, for always trying to include me, and for suggesting that others do so too. You introduced me to extraordinary women. Many of them are here. Some of them are speaking. Some have passed on, died in short. And as you know, some of these women became very dear to me. It was a privilege to be your friends. I will never forget you. You symbolized a moment in history. And I have this to say about it. Despite everything, despite anything, I wouldn't have missed this revolution, not for love or money. I remain forever loyal to that moment in time, that collective awakening, which set me free from my former life as a girl. Allow me to paraphrase Shakespeare's King Henry V's most memorable speech. She that outlives this day and comes safe home, then will she strip her sleeve and show her scars and say, these wounds I had. This story shall the good woman teach her children from this day to the ending of the world, but we in it shall be remembered. We few, we happy few, we band of sisters, for she today that sheds her blood with me shall be my sister, be she near so vile. This day shall gentle her condition, and gentle women everywhere now abed shall think themselves accursed they were not here and hold their humanity cheap while any speak that fought with us.
My cane, my cane.
When Kate and I met almost 50 years ago, she was feverishly busy interviewing prostitutes from the back of her Buick convertible, tearing wallpaper off the walls of an old farmhouse, walking to Albany in support of gay political candidates, and planning a movie about three women living in America. I could not keep track. I was at the time exploring another way of life, the practice of meditation and, you might say, non-thinking. We were on different paths and yet instantly enjoyed a rather remarkable connection. She, of course, was celebrating the early success of sexual politics and forming lifelong friendships in what was the first lesbian feminist consciousness-raising group in New York City. This included Barbara Love, Sidney Abbott, Jane O. Wyatt, Phyllis Berkby, Nath Rockhill, and Alma Rotsong, among others. After our meetings, we all trooped over to a women's bar on 14th Street and often danced to the night they drove old Dixie down. There were other women there, of course, furtive in corners, dykes in the old sense, but we were from another planet, so we thought. We had discovered sisterhood. The guys at the door left us alone. Kate was an improbable celebrity, a spokesperson for feminism. Her phone was always ringing, which was one reason she liked to visit me just around the corner from the Bowery loft she shared with the wonderful Fumio. She was first an intellectual, of course, a bookworm at the top of her form, but no ordinary one. Nobody in the world could pinpoint the disingenuousness and general wrongheadedness of politicians
with the brio and energy of Kate Millett. Our breakfast, perusing the New York Times, were filled with hilarity, scrambled eggs, coffee, and heavy cream, too. An old lawnmower wheezed back and forth in the marble cemetery below my window, the caretaker coughing every now and again. How young and strong we felt, how superior to the old and dead. We always talked about what we were reading. In authentic old English, Kate could recite portions of the Canterbury Tales, and often did. She insisted I read Violette Leduc's La Bâtarde. She was extraordinarily taken with Leduc's raw, confessional, somewhat messy style. The whole trajectory of her writing career was now profoundly influenced by this protege of Simone de Beauvoir. No more Mandarin mid-Atlantic prose of Sexpaul, as Kate now dismissively referred to her first success. About this time, I took Kate to see Dorothy Day, whose house of hospitality was on East First Street, where I had helped on the soup line. It was thrilling to see them, the social reprobate and the servant of God, sitting close together at a long table, chain smoking, and talking in low voices about nonviolence for hours. They both lived on the Bowery, political radicals committed to social justice and human dignity. Dorothy Day founded the Catholic Worker and defended the poor and the forsaken. Kate fought for the rights of women, lesbians, gays, sex workers, the elderly, the tortured, and finally the mentally ill. Dorothy Day has since been recognized by the church as living a life of, quote, heroic virtue, unquote, and is on the path to sainthood. Perhaps our most important bond was that we both were occupied with what we called veritas, what it was, how to acquire it, how it's lost. The qualities I most cherished about this early Kate were her exquisite clarity of mind, her sense of the absurd, and her moral judgment, which I deemed infallible. I shared her sense of the absurd, made her laugh, and she thought I was kind. She began calling me Clarky. Influenced by Leduc's terrible candor, she exposed in her next books the most personal aspects of her emotional, sexual, and psychological life to a social landscape that was hostile. And Kate experienced a cruel, in-your-face pushback that left her very vulnerable. Thus, her real pilgrimage had begun, as had mine. In 1972, I took a 10-year hiatus in ashrams and reluctantly abandoned the Lower East Side, the feminist movement, my CR group, and most especially Kate, who soon left for an extended stay in California. About halfway through this self-imposed exile, Kate returned and found me in my modest urban ashram in Jamaica, Queens. She was dealing unsuccessfully with acute manic depression and was talking too fast and had acquired a menacing tone I was not used to. Looking worn out and rumpled, she described how people complained when she didn't wear pants at the farm and the police were constantly being called for one reason or another. I was working at a place called Guru Health Foods, wearing a sari and sneakers, making endless bags of fruit and nut mix, and trying to become a vegetarian by eating cashews and dried pineapple. We became hysterical, trying to figure out what had happened to our lives and who was crazier. When she finally drove away, top down, black hair flying in the wind, she shouted over her shoulder, "Clarky, call me when you find something." I stayed 5 years in these ashrams. And finally, when I returned from a 5-month trip to India, I rejoined Kate and her new love, Sophie Keir. Lived in the philosophy section of the loft, and became eventually the mother of the farm. The farm.
At the farm, Kate was finally president of her own university. She created a special curriculum for women artists and writers from all over the world. How to be intrepid. How to create and appreciate beauty. How to endure physical, impossibly different labors. How to survive heat, lime ticks, poison ivy, exhaustion, each other. How to be radicals by going to the root of everything. Sophie was the chief engineer, the general contractor, the master electrician and plumber, and most important, the soother of souls and anything else she needed to be. Myself, I emptied ashtrays, cooked lots of meat, kept naked women out of the kitchen, swam with Kate every day, reflecting on the day's events, and presided over the dining room dinner conversation, constantly trying to raise the tone. We all remember the loosestrife, the elm over the pond, the light, the great blue heron, champagne on the sunset hill, the sounds of the women laughing through open windows, their confidence growing every day. Everyone who came to the farm was altered. Each one of you, in your own way, has moved us forward. Today, we are here to celebrate the wayward American original who so successfully struggled with the conservative canon at Oxford, who learned to drive a tractor up and down steep hills, who planted and harvested and sold Christmas trees, who wrote 11 books translated into 9 languages, who created and led a utopian women's artist colony, and built her own silkscreen studio and sculpture studio, who defied every convention, who changed our world, all the while dealing with an unruly mind. In 1981, she hastily wrote in pencil under a little watercolor of her beloved red tractor. Every day, holding it together, just as it comes apart again. Another leaves, something else breaks or won't start. The money's gone, or the weather turns against us. Big as life, this farm, filling the whole sky with passion. Some might deny my friend lived the life of heroic virtue, which she so desperately craved. But no one can ever deny that Kate Millett was big as life. Thank you.
As we go marching, marching in the beauty of the day, a million darkened kitchens, a thousand millots gray, are touched with all the radiance that a sudden sun discloses. For the people hear us singing, bread and roses, bread and roses. As we go marching, marching, we battle too for men, for they are women's children, and we nurture them again. Our lives shall not be sweated from birth until life closes. Hearts starve as well as bodies, give us bread and give us roses. Marching, marching, unnumbered women dead. for roses too. As we go marching, marching, we bring the greater days. For the rising of the women means the rising of the race. No more the drudge and idler, tend that toil where one reposes, but a sharing of life's glories. Give us bread and give us roses.
Kate's favorite line was, hearts starve as well as bodies.
Dear friends, it is with a heavy heart that I send greetings to all those gathered this afternoon to honor and celebrate the life of Kate Millett. Kate was an extraordinary woman whose fierce brilliance and pioneering work shaped the feminist movement, inspiring and informing decades of conversations about gender, sexuality, the family, and society. Hers was a unique and original voice, and I will always be grateful for her contributions to the women's movement both here and around the world. As you come together today to shed a tear, share a laugh, and remember and celebrate Kate's life and work, please know that my warmest wishes and heartfelt condolences are with you, her spouse, Sophie, and all whose lives she touched. With warm regards, I am sincerely yours, Hillary Rodham Clinton. I am deeply sorry I cannot be here today with you all. But the fine actor, Kathleen Turner, is graciously giving voice to those words. She made me say that. Excerpted from a piece I wrote after the loss of Kate called Dancing into Shadow. You can find the piece online. We met in the late 1960s, amid the furious budding of contemporary feminism. I'd heard about an interesting dissertation dealing with sexism and literature being written by some feminist artist newly back from years living in Japan, and I tracked her down. Warm but shy, she let me read her dissertation, and I convinced her to let me publish an excerpt from it in an anthology I was compiling, a little book called Sisterhood is Powerful. But it's just a dissertation, she shrugged. Only academics will be interested, not the general public. Nevertheless, the inclusion of that excerpt triggered editors' interest in that dissertation, which became a little book called Sexual Politics. Both activists, we ran into one another at demonstrations and meetings and became friends, but friends in a different way from other political friendships, because both of us were also artists. Kate, a sculptor and painter, me, a poet and writer. This was the constant thread that would run through decades of our friendship. Even when we quarreled or were at outs with one another, Kate always showed up at my poetry readings, and I always showed up at her art exhibits. Yet Kate was also with me on the boardwalk in Atlantic City at that first Miss America pageant protest in 1968. She then volunteered her Bowery loft for a dance to raise funds for lawyers' fees, since some of our women had been arrested in Atlantic City. For years after, we laughed ruefully about what happened. Hundreds of people showed up and danced long and energetically, literally breaking her floor, which then required serious shoring up so as not to collapse the whole building. And the bail money ultimately went, at least a partial way, toward that. Kate and I differed on how we handled that fame, notoriety, as well as that rare moment of solvency that followed. When Sisterhood is Powerful took off like a rocket, I started the first feminist grant-giving foundation, the Sisterhood is Powerful Fund, and poured the royalties into it so that money could build the movement, create rape crisis centers, battery shelters, feminist periodicals, and so forth. It never occurred to me to do otherwise. Kate, who proudly acknowledged she was at heart an Irish peasant, scolded me, "Robin, don't be a fool." She urged me to do what she was doing, use the royalties to buy real estate. She bought a farm in upstate New York for her own use and delight, eventually to become a woman's art colony. Kate was probably right. I sometimes had trouble paying my electric bill, but I didn't touch the royalties. Nevertheless, the SIP fund was depleted in time. The farm will last, part of Kate's legacy. It became a legend, an Amazonian arts colony that grew holiday trees to help sustain itself. And Kate, ever the true bohemian, could be found on a Manhattan street corner at Christmas time, selling her trees to people totally unaware of their mittened saleswoman's identity. The farm was where Kate wrote her books and made her art, the large fat lady statues, the ink on paper drawings, the silkscreen work she devised so that she could produce inexpensive prints average folks could afford, since she felt strongly everyone should be able to have art, real, original art, in their homes. The farm was where friends came and went, especially in late August, to celebrate Obon, the Japanese festival of the dead, of the ancestors. The Obon feast was observed by lighting candles inside small paper bags, makeshift lanterns, then setting them adrift on a tiny leaf and twig raft across the pond where their lights floated into darkness. Kate loved playing hospitable matriarch, and I always felt welcome. When I embarked on hosting a series of home-cooked dinner to bridge artist friends and political friends in Manhattan, Kate was a regular, since she qualified in both categories. A feminist generation is marching again, this time into shadow. Another generation will march into the sun. Kate's feminist writing stands tall among the work that changed consciousness and saved lives. But to find the friend I'll miss, I'll look at a large black ink on white paper work of hers I have. There are her lyrical, witty, Japanese-influenced swoops and dots that gradually registered to the eye as a woman's buttock, thigh, vulva, and clitoris. Like its maker, this spare yet lush exuberance of flesh exposes itself with such sensual purity, it shocks. To find the friend I miss, I will look for the flame of her flickering in a soft summer wind as it dances across dark waters into the night. Robin Morgan.
Chère Kate, chère Sophie, chères toutes et chers tous, c'est avec beaucoup d'émotion que j'ai l'honneur, avec vous tous et toutes, de rendre hommage à Kate Millett, disparue à Paris, dans la ville où je vis. C'est à Paris que j'ai eu l'immense privilège de te rencontrer, Kate, et c'est là où nous avions prévu de nous retrouver de nouveau en septembre pour poursuivre un projet commun que j'évoquerai un peu plus loin.
Dear Kate, dear Sophie, dear everyone, it is with deep emotion I have the honor to pay tribute to Kate Millett, who passed away in Paris, the city I live in. It was in Paris that I had the great privilege of meeting Kate, and it was there that we planned to meet in September to pursue a common project I will explain later.
Très tôt, tes livres qui arrivaient en France avec un décalage d'un an ont été mes compagnons de réflexion, de lutte et de passion. Sexual Politics, traduit en français par la politique du mal, donnait euphoniquement au titre en français un double sens à l'ironie caustique, mal, male and mal, evil. Ce livre, très fine analyse du patriarcat comme institution politique et culturelle, signait la possibilité de l'affranchissement des femmes, de la conquête du corps et d'une libre sexualité. Je te cite, « Le sexe est une catégorie sociale ayant des implications politiques. »
Very early on, your books, which arrive in France with a year's delay, were my thoughtful companions of struggles and passions. Sexual politics, translated in La politique du mal, gave a double meaning to the caustic irony. Mal equals male, and mal equals evil. This book's very refined analysis of the patriarchy as a political and cultural institution signaled the possibility for women's assertiveness, control of their bodies, and sexual liberation. Sex is social class with political implications.
En 1975, deux ans après la publication de ton livre « The Prostitution Papers », et alors qu'une grève de prostituées éclate en France, tu débats de la prostitution et tu questionnes le rôle du patriarcat dans l'exploitation et la persécution des minorités avec des féministes françaises, notamment Monique Wittig et Christine Delphi. Delphine Seyrig filme alors les états généraux de la prostitution et se fera ta traductrice. Un film qui est présent dans les collections du Centre audiovisuel Simone de Beauvoir que je dirige, intitulé « Kate Millett parle de la prostitution avec des féministes » en témoigne. Ce film est toujours très regardé et commenté. Tu y déclarais, et je te cite, « C'est en nous opposant les unes les autres, les mamans et les putains, que les hommes nous contrôlent et même s'il est vrai que la prostitution est en un sens un esclavage, il faut à tout prix ne pas mépriser les prostituées. » Les prostituées ont le sentiment qu'on les condamne elles-mêmes lorsqu'on condamne la prostitution. Il s'agit de parvenir à une compréhension, à une solidarité avec les prostituées.
In 1975, 2 years after the publication of your book, The Prostitution Papers, as a strike of prostitutes exploded in France, you debated prostitution and questioned the role of the patriarchy in the exploitation and persecution of minorities with French feminists, among others, Monique Wittig and Christine Delphi. Delphine Seyrig, who was filming The State of Prostitution, was the translator. A film included in the collection of the audiovisual Simone de Beauvoir Center, which I direct, is entitled Kate Millett and discusses prostitution with feminists. This film is still very much viewed and discussed. You say it is by opposing one another, mothers and prostitutes, that men control us, and even if true, that prostitution in one way is a kind of slavery, at no cost must one despise prostitutes. The prostitutes feel condemnation when one condemns prostitution. It is about attaining a comprehension, a solidarity with the prostitutes.
Entre 1975 pardon, et 1978, dans deux de tes livres, Envol et Sita, tu partages les réflexions intimes avec une telle force que cela me bouleversait comme la militante féministe lesbienne que je suis. Au même moment, dans l'État de New York, toujours pionnière dans tes actions, tu crées La Ferme, un collectif de femmes artistes que tu définis ainsi. Nous avons créé un paradis, une colonie vivant en autosuffisance, composée de femmes qui ont travaillé dur à ce que nous aimons faire, l'art et la communauté.
Between 1975 and 1978, in your book Flying and Sita, you share intimate thoughts with great strengths, which move deeply the lesbian militant feminist that I am. In upstate New York, always a pioneer in your actions, you created The Farm, a women's art colony, which you define as follow. We created a paradise, a self-sustained colony, including women who have worked hard at what we love to do, art and community.
En 1979, après la chute du Shah, tu seras en Iran avec Sophie et d'autres féministes, notamment lors de la grande manifestation de femmes iraniennes. Tout ce que vous avez enregistré, photographié et filmé sortira du pays malgré la répression et ton expulsion. À ton retour, lors d'une conférence de presse à la Mutualité de Paris, fin mars 1979, tu déclares très clairement, et je te cite, « Si les femmes n'obtiennent pas des droits égaux à ceux des hommes, cela ne valait pas la peine de renverser la tyrannie. »
In 1979, after the Shah's fall, you were in Iran with Sophie and other feminists during the large Iranian women's demonstrations. Everything you recorded, photographed, and filmed, you got out of the country in spite of your expulsion and the repression. Upon your return during a press conference at the Mutuality in Paris, end of March 1979, you clearly declared, if women don't get equal rights to men, it wasn't worth bringing down tyranny.
À Paris, toujours, où tu faisais des séjours très réguliers pour rencontrer Simone de Beauvoir, tu rencontrais également des militantes féministes, et lors de l'enterrement de Simone de Beauvoir en 1986, tu étais présente, et voici ce que tu déclarais. Simone de Beauvoir était importante pour moi comme personne, comme écrivaine, comme féministe. J'ai rencontré tous les ans Simone de Beauvoir pendant 16 ans, jusqu'en 1986. Cette visite était importante pour moi, cela me nourrissait. Une personne très importante pour moi avait quitté ma vie, elle avait été un guide pour moi, et j'ai appris à vivre grâce au livre de Simone de Beauvoir.
You visited Paris regularly to see Simone de Beauvoir every year during a 16-year period until 1986. Those visits were important for me. They nourished me. A very important person for me left my life. She was a mentor for me. I learned to live thanks to Simone de Beauvoir's books.
Il y a 4 ans, Sophie et toi avez exprimé le souhait de déposer tout ce travail sur les femmes iraniennes au Centre du Visuel Simone de Beauvoir à Paris pour qu'il soit conservé, documenté et valorisé. Ce fut un grand bonheur et surtout une immense responsabilité d'accueillir tout ce matériel unique et remarquable dans notre collection. Avec nos partenaires à Paris, la Bibliothèque nationale de France et le Centre national du cinéma, nous avons entamé un travail autour de ce fonds.
4 years ago, you and Sophie wished to donate all your work on the Iranian women to the Simone de Beauvoir Audiovisual Center in Paris for its conservation, documentation, and appraisal. It was at the same time a great joy and enormous responsibility to welcome all this unique material in our collection, with our partners, the French National Library and the National Film Center, we have started working with this collection.
Depuis cette rencontre autour du matériel que nous avons appelé Iran 1979, j'ai partagé avec toi, chère Kate, et avec Sophie, des séances de travail, des discussions très animées, de grands éclats de rire que tu avais très généreux, et de très bons repas. Tu aimais la langue française, et lorsqu'un mot m'échappait en anglais, tu traduisais. Tu as même grimpé les 4 étages de nos locaux pour venir rencontrer mon équipe, et ça a été vraiment un moment inoubliable pour nous toutes.
Since this meeting concerning the material Iran 1979, I share with you, D. Kate, and so with Sophie, working sessions, animated discussion, lots of generous big laughs, and great meal. You like the French language, and when a word escaped in English, you translate it. You climbed the 4 flights of stairs of our location to meet my staff, an unforgettable sharing moment.
Dans le film Hommage de Kate Millett à Simone de Beauvoir, filmé par Anne Faisandi en 1986, tu disais « Avec le deuxième sexe, Simone de Beauvoir a ouvert une porte et nous a dit pourquoi nous devions vivre, pourquoi nous devions nous battre pour être des êtres libres, pourquoi nous devions transcender notre condition dans une société patriarcale. »
In the film Tribute from Kate Millett to Simone de Beauvoir, filmed by Anne Fresander in 1986, you said, with the second sex, Simone de Beauvoir opened the door and told us why we must live, why we needed to fight to be free human beings, why we need to transcend our condition in a patriarchal society.
Et tu poursuivais par ces mots en signifiant que nous avons pris le relais et que nous ne devons rien lâcher. Je te cite, Simone de Beauvoir a prouvé que le féminisme est un grand humanisme. Nous sommes une immense force historique, rien ne peut nous arrêter.
By these words you have pointed out, we have taken the reins and must hold on tight. Simone de Beauvoir has proved that feminism is a great humanism. We are a great historical force. Nothing can stop us.
En écho, je te dirai, Kate, qu'avec tes écrits, ton travail d'artiste, ta vie, tes amours et ton militantisme avec les femmes du monde entier, tu as amplifié la vision et le vécu de Simone de Beauvoir. Repose en paix, Kate.
In response, I would say, Kate, with all your writing, your artworks, your life, your passions, and your militancy with the women of the whole world, you amplified the vision and life of Simone de Beauvoir. Rest in peace, Kate. Nicole Fernandez Ferrer, Executive Director of the Simone de Beauvoir Audio Visual Center. And I just want to say one more thing. They will be in tribute, a memorial service for Kate that will take place in Paris, April 3rd, with the film archives and Sophie's presence.
Well, Kate Millett. Kate Millett came in my life with her sister, Mallory Millett, Mallory Jones, who lived in a loft on East 4th Street across from the fire station where the fire trucks were going off 24 hours a day. And I was living with Mallory with a suitcase full of photographs of women that I had been photographing in Los Angeles. Most of them, many of them, were from the Actors Studio because I found those women fearless, intelligent, and brave. So Kate did too. And Mallory said, you know, with this great suitcase, I remember it had gold rings around it. Mallory says, you gotta meet my sister. So one day in 75, Kate appeared on the balcony, fire escape. And I had my camera, and I photographed her, and we had this immediate connection. I said, oh, this is what I'm doing. I'm creating a new woman. I'm creating a new pathway so women can stand strong and be who they are. They don't have to be anything but find their core and their inner voice. So Kate taught me that, and Kate agreed with me, and now I hope I can find this poem that I've been practicing forever. But Kate, I love her, and I will always love her. She's a great teacher, a great lover, and a great artist. And I was her muse during the 70s. I helped her improvise Basement. She'd be this hateful woman destroying Sylvia, or I'd be Sylvia, or she'd be Sylvia, and we'd switch back and forth, improvisation a la Actor Studio. And so I really understand the pain of suffering of those who hurt and those who are hurt. They're all caught in a terrible web, a web, and it has to stop. And women are going to be the ones who can stop it, because we are different, and we are stronger and freer, because we have not been brainwashed to think like a man. We don't have to be all those things. And I thought this morning at 2 a.m., I don't know, I looked at Rachel and I said, oh, those women unseated 11 men in Virginia, it can be done. But you have to do it. You have to be strong and fearless and be a warrior, as Kate was. So this is for my dear, dear friend. Do not go gentle into that good night. Old age should burn and rave at close of day. Rage, rage against the closing of the light. The wise men at their end know dark is right. Because their words had forked no lightning, they do not go gentle into that good night. Good men, the last wave by, crying how bright their frail deeds might have danced in a green bay, do not rage, rage against the dying of the light. Wild men who caught and sang the sun in flight and learned too late, they grieved it on its way. Do not go gentle into that good night. Grave men near death who see with blinding sight, blind eyes could blaze like meteors and be gay. Rage, rage against the dying of the light. And you, my friend, there on the sad height, curse, bless me now with your fierce tears. I pray, do not go gentle into that good night. Rage, rage against the dying of the light. Okay.
Oh, you're recording. I guess I better leave that here. Sorry. Best laid plans. I am open and I am willing for to be hopeless. Would seem so strange. It dishonors those who go before us. So lift me up to the light of change. There is a hurting in my family, and there is sorrow in my town. There is a panic
all across the nation, and there is wailing the whole world round. But I am open and I am willing, for to be hopeless would seem so strange. It dishonors those who go before us. So lift me up to the light of change. May the children see more clearly, and may the elders be more wise. May the winds of change caress us, even though they burn our eyes. I am open and I am willing, and I am willing, for to be hopeless, for to be hopeless would seem so strange, it dishonors those who go before us, those who go before us. So lift me up. So lift me up to the light of change, to the light of change. Give me a mighty oak to hold my confusion, and give me a desert to hold my fear. Give me a sunset to hold my wonder, and give me an ocean to hold my tears. But I am open and I am willing, for to be hopeless would seem so strange. It dishonors those who go before us. So lift me up to the light of change. We are a gentle, angry people, and we are singing, singing for our lives. We are a gentle, angry people, and we are singing, singing for our lives. We are a land of many colors. We are a land of many colors. And we are singing, singing for our lives. We are a land of many colors. And we are singing, singing for our lives. I wrote this song after Harvey Milk and Mayor Moscone were assassinated in San Francisco. And there was such a great sadness. And yet people realized that they could take their anger and their hurt and their rage and put it to work to build a movement, which I feel is very much in keeping with what I've heard people say about Kate. Of how do you take that intelligence, that anger, those feelings, that rage, that understanding of beauty, and build something bigger than oneself? And the night we sang it out in Castro Street, people sang, "We are gay and lesbian people," and then allies picked it up and sang, "We are gay and straight together," and then we learned more about sexuality, and now I can't put all the words into the meter of the song. So the last verse we can sing, "We are all in this together," but I hope you'll take a moment to listen to the sound of this afternoon, the voices that you've heard, the stories that you've heard, the sound of the day, and take into your hearts
the look of the day, the look of your comrades and your sisters, and looking at people that you have spent a lifetime with. And later on, when you might feel discouraged or cynical, to bring this moment back, this moment right here, remembering that millions of people all over the world have worked with you to discover what it means to achieve peace, to demand justice, and to exemplify feminism and lesbian feminism. What does it require to hold the weight of the horrors of the world and at the same time hold the weight of the spectacular beauty that thrives on this planet? It is our job, I believe, as conscientious people to be able to be, to hold that full spectrum of life from the horror to the greatness and to move forward with grace, dignity, and courage. I believe that is what Kate meant to do. To be big enough to hold the full spectrum. She was an example of that, and so are the friends of Kate Millett. And in these trying times, most importantly, let's not forget who we are. We are all in this together, and we are singing, singing for our lives. We are all in this together, and we are singing, singing for our lives. We are a peaceful, loving people. We are a peaceful, loving people. And we are singing, singing for our lives. We are a peaceful, loving people, and we are singing, singing for our lives. Thank you, Kate.
Okay, we're almost at the end, very close. We have the church for a while, so you want to stay and socialize and talk to people, we've got it, and you can do that. We also have the memory books that I hope everybody will sign before they leave. I would ask now that all of you rise, please, and give a rousing applause, a round of rousing applause for Kate Millett, her life and her work. Kate. Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you for coming.